Good morning, Spain. How lovely to have you with us once again. With Easter around the corner and summer on the horizon, this week we're going to take a look at different places around Spain that perhaps you've never thought of visiting. Hannah is going to be talking about fictional books set in wartime Spain. We'll be talking fashion and fitness with our fashion and fitness editor, Kate Hill. In Snout and About, we're talking about little dogs. We'll be going to Madrid to see His Royal Highness Ambassador, Mr. Hugh Elliott. Hannah Alonso Bartlett, I said it right, I didn't say Jana. Hannah Alonso Bartlett is going to be talking about romantic relationships. And this week, Chef Nick is going to be cooking with kids. We've got a lot of things to do in the programme, and that's just a sample of what's coming up. But let's start right now with the lovely Kate Hill and Nando Brown. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. So many things going up in the programme, and it's like, what's happening? What are the things that are happening? We should have one of those screens that you can just read it all.
Yeah. Yeah. The pointers.
Exactly, the pointers. But enough, I think, to wet your whistle for all the great things that are coming up. Lovely to see you both. You're looking gorgeous as always. Oh, and how curious, because you have a tendency to dress in sporty fashion.
Yes.
And that is, I don't know if you set the trend, but it would seem so, because this is really a trend now, mixing sport with fashion. I mean, this is a big deal and it's taking off as a fad, as like a new thing.
It's such a huge thing now, as you say, like people go to their Pilates class and then they go out for the whole day. So it's like, right, okay, I need to wear something that's fashionable enough that I can go out in. I'm saying this, but I did have a very malfunction on the weekend where I had a fashion.
Yeah. Tell us more.
I went to a Pilates class and thought, right, okay, I'll just quickly put this tracksuit on, thinking that I was going to go home after. Ended up being out the whole day. And let's just say it was a sack. To the point that the next day, my husband said to me, Kate, please don't wear that tracksuit out again. And you know, when you start thinking to yourself, just like, okay, right, yeah, no, completely right. But I think, it, as you say, it really does go on that.
You're surprising, though, because you always, when I see you, and even when we coincide out and about, you always have very fitting outfits on. So it's funny to know that you even own a baggy one.
Oh, honestly, very, very disaster. But as you say, I think after that, I started reading up on, like, on different brands and how they are really merging into that. And there's this one brand called Barlow who I am obsessed about. So they have made it. So they've basically got weights and they've got different accessories that you can use when you're doing different exercises, but they have made it into such a fashion that it's basically like you cannot be seen without your Barla weights or your Barla bar or something. And they've made them colourful, they've done fashion shoots with them. So to the fact that they've done their fashion shoots, so it's like you need to get your Barla bracelets, and so they're using the weights as jewellery now.
Oh, honestly, my God.
Whatever will they think of? Anything.
I know.
Wow, great marketing.
But honestly,
weights as jewellery?
Yeah.
Be like, wait till you got your necklace on, you're like, can you?
I imagine you're thinking more like the ones, as you say, on your wrists or on your ankles, maybe,
yeah,
to have that extra weight. No, that's what they do. I mean, I don't do any of that stuff, so I wouldn't know.
It's so interesting, though, because, yeah, it's like you go from your class and it's like, okay, I'll just wear the weights on my arms as my bracelet.
I'll just wear the weights. That's crazy.
Yeah, but honestly, it sounds crazy, but it looks so cool. Like, as I say, they've made it into such a trend and they've made it as a fashion statement that you do a fashion shoot now with your accessories. Instead of jewellery, you've now got your weights.
Well, the sports do seem to be taking over.
For the fellas, they've got these are like smart tracksuit bottoms.
Mm-hmm. I didn't realise they were tracksuit bottoms.
They're literally
and you
just
do look
bottoms,
you do look very smart.
Like, oh, thank you very much.
they're very fashionable.
So comfortable, yeah, but you don't look like a pikey.
And I think that's the thing, that there isn't, as you say, like you want something comfortable that you can move around in all day, but you can go to dinner or you can go out to the family. But and it's really weird because even Nike now are doing like that more formal range. They've got like the smart jumpers, they even have blazers now. Can you believe that? So as you say, they are merging into like that style more like a Zara or something that is something that, yeah, is smart enough that you can go the full day in.
I mean, I think 20 years ago we'd go to the trade fairs and you'd see all these if you see anyone walking around dressed and in sneakers, it's like, oh, American.
Yeah.
You know, it was like such a faux pas on fashion to see these people in their suits and they're this, but they were walking around in sneakers. And the change in the last two decades to see now that you actually just wear sneakers, it's something to do. Me, that like, don't like to wear heels so much now. I'm delighted that there's this fashion of just being comfortable.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing, isn't
it? But smart. Like,
Yeah, and even like weddings now, a lot of people just wear like a really fashionable pair of trainers to their wedding.
Because, oh yeah, they do, don't they? That's a thing. Yeah.
Like, and so as you say, I think it is more of that, like, you can be fashionable, but you need to be comfortable. But obviously, as you say, you still want to look good.
Look good, though.
You're wearing a tracksuit or something like that.
The comfortable shoe, I well embrace that. It's healthier for everybody.
Yeah, but as you say now, it's just, if anything, everyone's in trainers, isn't it? Like, they've got so many different styles, so many different collaborations that come out.
So now it's not just the trainers, you've got to go out with your weights.
Yeah.
if you're anyone, you know, like, in, especially in your world, it's a very... healthy world, isn't it, nowadays? Like, there's a lot of people getting into the health kick and doing things, and it's very seen to be at the gym. I mean, more than actually maybe working out, it's just seen to be working out. I was seen there. I was like,
as you say, you want to get like your next outfit to try out, but is, as you say, are they actually going to the gym to work out or just to wear their new look?
Exactly. The good thing is, if you dress the part, nobody knows the difference, only you. So some of the differences that you might not know are what the rural villages in Spain have to offer. It's a completely different experience. In fact, it's a Spanish experience. And so many people come to Spain and never get to see what Spain is all about. But those are the little things that one gets to appreciate when you've actually visited the real heart of Spanish Spain. There are 79 pueblos, villages, towns that have been recommended. Let's take a look.
Are you ready to experience the real Spain? From north to south, and from east to west. Places full of life, to make you feel like never before. Enjoy the traditions. Taste our gastronomy and discover magical spots alive with culture. Just waiting to be discovered with your five senses. Discover the most beautiful villages in Spain.
Joining us in the studio once again is the lovely Jana Alonso Bartlett. How are you, my love? I love the colour. One of my favourites. It's just
gorgeous.
So. Is that lilac or is it?
I think
there's so many different names of
fashion on the sofa.
I think definitely a bit of a lilac going on, isn't it?
The colour is absolutely looks wonderful on you.
Thank you.
It's absolutely gorgeous. And you're going to be talking about romantic relationships, and I think that's an interesting subject for those that have one.
And those that don't.
Ah, tell us more.
It's such a good topic.
It is such a good topic, and the reason that I want to talk about romantic relationships is, generally speaking, everyone wants to meet someone. But what we're taught in our society about romantic relationships isn't very helpful. We're taught that if you meet the right person, it works. And that's not true. Every movie that you watch, boy meets girl or whatever, right? And then the movie ends. So no one talks about what happens after you meet someone.
I had this conversation just the other day that all the fairy tales, and it just ends with, and they live happily ever after.
And then what happens in the happily ever after?
They never leave the house, they never talk to each other. No one takes out the rubbish.
Never any challenges, there are no problems. You know, and so we've got this idea, and all of us do, because it's part of the cultural programming, that it either works because it's the right person, and if it's the right person, it works. Or then we've got another kind of wave of movies that are coming out now, and they're being realistic, and they're showing divorce and pain. They're saying, this is the reality of relationships. And the actual reality is in the middle, like everything. So the way that relationships work is that you're always going to have yourself projected in your relationship. You're always going to see your stuff in your relationship. However great the person is, however wonderful the relationship is, you're going to have to resolve your stuff for the relationship to work, right? So they say if you don't resolve your childhood trauma, you'll have to go through it in your romantic relationships. And they say it because it's true. So the middle road is, yes, you can have a happily ever after. Yes, you can have a honeymoon that lasts, you know, 30, 40, 50, 60 years, but you have to commit to doing the work. And the work doesn't look like blaming your partner and telling them all the ways they have to change. It means looking at yourself, looking at all the places, all the blind spots that you've got that are gonna come up with your romantic relationship. So we can have the honeymoon, we can have the happily ever after, but we've got to work for it.
And do you know what, that is so true, because someone actually said that as well, when your relationship starts, that in a way, kind of when the hard work begins. And it's weird, that really does kind of stick in your mind, because at the time you think, hard work starts, like, what do you mean? But it is true, every day you get challenges, like taking the bin out, and you think, right, which kind of conversations do I challenge? Which ones do I roll with?
And you've got the addition as well of having a different nationality husband.
Yeah.
And those also, just the cultural differences of things that you've grown up doing perhaps one way, and he's done another, and there's like, which one do we choose?
Yeah.
Not necessarily one's better or worse, it's just, what do we adapt within the mutual couple?
And as you say, like, actually talking about that as well and really communicating it, because otherwise things get lost in translation, or one person thinks one thing. And
it's more than communicating it, because everyone thinks that we solve relationship problems through communication. That's not true. There's a lot of couples that communicate a lot and it doesn't work. It's that you have to look at your own inner wounds. You have to look at your own patterning that is being triggered by the relationship. Mm. I love what you said, you know, the work starts when you meet someone, because when you're alone, you feel so good. There's no one triggering you. Of course you feel good. When you're in a relationship, you know, let's say, you know, as a child, I was bullied in primary school. And so I learned about myself in primary school. I learned that I don't belong. I learned all of these things that play out in your unconscious mind as an adult. So you've got a belief system that I don't belong, right? And I'm not loved. So maybe when you're in a relationship, your partner's going to do something that isn't actually hurtful, but you're going to go, they're rejecting me. They're abandoning me.
Yeah, is that association?
And so you end up playing out programming from your childhood as an adult, but that's your opportunity to heal it. So for example, my partner, we've been together for 3.5 years, and his father left when he was 6, okay? So what did he learn when his dad left when he was 6? He learned, you know, love doesn't last. He learned that, you know, when it's going really good, don't trust it, because something bad's gonna happen. Mm. And so that plays out in our relationship. And we don't fix that by communicating about it. We do communicate about it, but he then goes and takes responsibility for that pattern. Oh, I'm aware, right, that I act this way, or I start to feel uncomfortable when the relationship's working really well. I notice I'm not trusting it. Okay, I'm gonna go do a session to clear my unconscious mind, or to move the emotion in my body, or to create actual change. Communication is the bare minimum.
Wow. It's curious, because it's reflecting what you said last week about just taking responsibility. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Again, it's not looking to place the blame of you're making me take the rubbish out, or I've got a busy day, because there's so many things that can come up. It's just in the sense of, okay, what can I do about it with myself, or maybe changing, and not look to immediately place the blame or the issue on somebody else.
Yeah.
But it's an interesting subject. I mean, you could go on.
It's huge, but the awareness is, there's a lot of people that think that they're bad at relationships, right? I had this relationship, I had that relationship, it didn't work out, it means that there's something intrinsically wrong with me, right? That's not true. The truth is that we've not been taught how to have relationships. No one's taught you how to do the work. No one's taught you how to have a healthy relationship. So of course you struggle. And so it's that awareness that I want to bring. It's not that people are bad at love, it's that we've not been taught how to have long-lasting love.
Also, if you had an abusive childhood in some way, from a parent or a relative, or with school, with children, in the sense of when it comes to the point of you growing up, to get away from that is very difficult if you're not aware that it's happening, because a lot of people don't even realize that the trauma is there, because you just kind of like block it away and just take it as the norm, which then tends to take you into a trend of looking for a romantic partner who reminds you of the love you had when you were a child, because you can't somehow justify it, that is what you deserve, that is how people love you. And so this relationship's not working, it might be just because you keep looking for that abusive relationship that mimics the only way you know how to be loved.
Mm-hmm. This is it, we as adults, we search for what is familiar. So we search for relationships that make us feel how we felt as a child. So if you felt unsafe as a child, you'll keep attracting partners that make you feel unsafe. They don't make you feel unsafe. It's the relationship and environment that leads to a feeling of unsafety. So this changes when you say, I'm going to stop doing the same things again and again and again, and I'm going to take responsibility for my stuff. And then the relationship, like magic, changes. There's so many times that I think it's my partner's fault, right? And then I realize, like, oh, wait a minute, this is mine. And then miraculously, he changes in front of my eyes because I've taken responsibility.
It's perception, isn't it?
It is perception.
It's so easy to blame somebody else, and we never want to blame ourselves. It's so easy just to look at that other person. If you hadn't have done this, but at the end of the day, if I hadn't reacted the way I did, for example, it is, it's very easy to look to judge. I think if we could all just take maybe one day and look and not judge anything, not ourselves, not anyone else, not the traffic, nothing, none of the above, would do us all a world of good.
It would be such a different world, wouldn't it?
It would be such a different world. But there's no reason why it can't be that way. Mm-hmm. It's like a snowball, isn't it? The effect that you hear it and maybe say something that you say that we said this morning, and it just resonates with somebody and they're like, oh, okay. And even if it's just one person, then it's worth it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So true, isn't it?
Thank you so much, girls. That has been very informative and hopefully helpful. We're now going over to the British Embassy to meet once again with His Royal Highness's Ambassador, Hugh Elliott. Join me. How wonderful to be back again with His Majesty's Ambassador, Hugh Elliott, here at the British Embassy in Madrid. Good morning, Ambassador. Lovely to see you again.
Good morning, Nicole. Very nice to see you too.
Very honoured that you're finding time for the Good Morning Spain team to come and just chat and know a little bit more about what the embassy is doing.
Well, it's nice. It's nice to join you, and it's nice to chat. And it's nice that people are interested in what we're doing.
They are interested. It's nice to see that we're getting good views on your interview. So very nice. When we were talking a few weeks back, you were saying about how pleasantly surprised you are to see that the mutual investment business-wise between UK and Spain, I was going to say England, but the UK and Spain has actually not suffered at all, and it's completely buoyant and everyone's still very enthusiastic regardless of the fears that they would all stop with Brexit. Are there other things that you're collaborating on apart from business, for example, education? Are there initiatives to help that run more smoothly?
There's a whole host of areas where we're collaborating. That certainly would bore all your viewers if I went through the whole lot, but let's just take one or two then. So education, absolutely. And people know how keen Spaniards are on learning English, and so promoting businesses who want to sort of sell services in English here is very important. We have the British Council here, which is the UK's cultural institute, which also, among other things, promotes English teaching and exams. And a specific thing that we did as the embassy, and this gets a bit to the heart about sort of what do the governments actually do here. Well, one thing we did was we did at the back end of last year, we negotiated a treaty with Spain, an agreement, whereby Spain would recognise the UK's academic qualifications at secondary level, so our A levels, for example, and vice versa. We would recognise Spanish qualifications. And this has got a very practical implication because it means that if you'd studied under the UK system, you could still go to university in Spain if you wanted to. And if you'd studied in the Spanish system, then your qualification would be recognised by the UK system. So that's just a small example, and that takes a lot of work.
But a very important one.
To negotiate that.
How many people have been here? How long did it take to negotiate? I mean, like, what's it like when you're sitting there? Is it like 30 of you there, or is it just one-on-one, head-to-head, giving it?
Well, frankly, all credit to my team, who did an amazing job on this, and to the Spanish Education Ministry and colleagues, because we all wanted to do this. It's just not straightforward when you're introducing something like this, because education systems and qualifications are things that are very carefully monitored, and people want to make sure that standards are maintained and that it can be compatible with, you don't want somebody who has a qualification, then they can't actually go on and they're not set up to learn at the next in a different educational environment. So you could have unintended consequences if you're not careful. But what the actual practicality is, it's very boring really. It's a series of meetings over the course of many months where you put together a text on the table which describes what you want to do, and you swap comments on that text, and you have meetings, and you find that there are things that you may or may not agree on, and you work through them, and you get to a deal. And that's the nuts and bolts of these sorts of things. And this case, it took a while, but it was relatively straightforward in the sense that we, both the UK and Spain, wanted this proximity on education, this collaboration, and that was great.
Makes a big difference when you've got two willing parties. There is a way when there is the will.
Exactly.
Very exactly. Good. Regarding security, you mentioned that briefly the last time we chatted, that obviously with the times we live in, this must be a priority for everybody.
Yes.
And it's funny hearing about how many swallows and the Brits now talk about having to go through the non-European passport controls, how much they hate it, they feel offended. Mm-hmm. It's quite funny, actually, how people feel offended that they're no longer going through the easy access. But I imagine security on many levels has been changed, and there's a lot of coordinating between you.
Well, the security is one of those areas where, to be honest, we have had excellent cooperation with Spain in the past, and we have excellent cooperation now. We have a team from the National Crime Agency, for example, that works as part of the embassy team. And one of their jobs, just to give you a practical example, a challenge in the UK is that challenge of firearm use. Now, some of those firearms may have come from Spain, where it is legal to have a firearm for use for blanks, for example, and there was a business exporting those to the UK, where they were then converted into lethal weapons, not legal in the UK at all. So as part of helping keep people safe, we have worked very closely with the Spanish authorities in order to clamp down on those illegal exports and keep the streets of the UK safe. And that requires excellent relationships with the Spanish police, the Spanish Guardia Civil, and all the authorities concerned with this sort of area. And that's what the team do on a day-to-day basis. They make sure the relationships are really, really good, so that when it comes to trying to get things done like that, like take guns off the streets in the UK, they get that collaboration from Spain. And I'm glad to say that we do have fantastic collaboration. And there's another example, actually, I could give, which is where, I mean, of course, we've said in the past about the number of Brits that come into Spain. Well, I would love to say that every one of those 18 million is a fine, upstanding citizen, but it is the case that one or two may not be. And we have actually worked with the Spanish police in a campaign which we called Los Más Buscados, the Most Wanted campaign, to try to seek the help of the British community and Spanish community in Spain to track down fugitives from the law arrest them and bring them to justice. And that has been an extremely successful campaign which we have run with the Spanish security ministry and the Spanish police.
Well, I have to say I'm completely surprised at the answers, in the sense of, yes, there are real security issues and some of them we create ourselves, but I would never have thought about the illegal arms dealings and things like that. Yeah. So yes, it's more than just passports and passport control, definitely.
It is, absolutely it is.
Well, we're very grateful. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Yeah. And we will be back very soon to ask more questions of His Majesty's Ambassador Hugh Elliott. If you have questions for His Majesty's Ambassador, please do drop us a line and we'll pass them on. Thank you so much.
Thanks very much, Nicole.
A big thank you to the Ambassador. It's always lovely to see him again, and quite an experience going to the embassy, I have to say. Good morning, girls.
Good morning. Good morning. Yeah, it's lovely listening to that, because it's good for us living here and also for people moving here. It's
definitely
good to know.
And now we were saying last week about good hook. Well, that's a good hook, because we're going to be talking to you about those who actually have an abundance of finance, whether it would be interesting for them to do a lucrative non-lucrative visa, yeah, or perhaps the golden visa, because they kind of like seem to cross over a little bit. How do we know which one to choose?
Well, the crossover, I suppose, is just the idea of the visa. They're actually very, very different. The golden visa, obviously you need to make an investment into the country, so that's 500,000 free of any mortgage or loan or anything. It's sort of a golden ticket to residency, so there's no consequence that comes with it in terms of becoming a tax resident of the country or anything like that. You only need to come into the country once every 6 months, and you need to keep your investment in Spain in order to keep renewing the visa. You can do that, you can apply for the visa either in your home country or through Spain, whereas a non-lucrative visa you can only apply for in your home country, in your in the consulate in your district. Now there are consequences with this visa where you do need to become a tax resident of Spain, you need to stay in the country for more than 183 days, and you need to exchange your driving license to a Spanish driving license. So for both visas you need to have proof of sufficient income, you need to have private medical insurance, you need to have a criminal record, you need to provide a criminal record certificate to say that you have no
criminal record
in the last 5 years in either of your in Spain or in your main residences. But there are slight differences to each visa, so I suppose yes, it's whether you have money spare to be able to invest and then look down the golden visa route.
So the golden visa route, you don't necessarily have to declare like taxes in Spain or change your driving license.
No, it's a golden ticket really to come into Spain, and as if it was before Brexit.
So just to be that status of you can just stay here.
Yes.
You'd have to worry about leaving every, like, for 6 months in, 6 months out, like you would do on a non-lucrative or no?
So the normal tourist visa, so if you didn't have any visa at all, is 90 days. So a Brit coming over to Spain has 90 days to stay before
But they don't need to get a visa.
They don't need to get a visa. So if you do have a second property here, and 3 months is enough for you, to be honest, that works. The only problem is that you have to then go back for a further 3 months before you can come back into the country, because otherwise you've outstayed your the 90 days. The golden visa, you only need to come in once every 6 months. You just need to keep it active. You kind of dip in, doesn't need to be for a certain amount of time. If you have a property here, you will need to pay non-residence tax, which is property tax, basically. So it's nothing to do with your worldwide assets. It's more just based on the property that you have here. But so that is the only tax you'd need to pay, whereas as on the non-lucrative visa, you will need to become a Spanish tax resident, and you will need to do la renta de declaraciones, which is the annual declaration, the tax declaration.
And you definitely need someone to help you with that.
Yeah. Yes. That's actually where we are just legal services.
Exactly. That's what you pass on. Go see the tax man.
Yeah.
And when you say investment in Spain with the golden visa, having 500,000 euros, do you mean that you need to invest that in property, or can it just be in the bank?
No, that's a very good question. I was focusing on property then, because that's the smallest investment you need to make. So the 500,000 is in property.
Okay.
Now you can make other investments. You could make an investment of £2 million into public debt in Spain, or into shares.
Oh, so instead of 500,000 on a home, let's put 2 million into clearing off Spanish debt.
Or
what would be the upside of that? The upside of putting money into Spanish debt.
I don't know.
There must be something, right? Otherwise, why would they offer it?
Yeah, I'm not entirely sure of that. I've never gone down that route, to be honest. We've just focused on the 500,000 because it is
just
sounds
nice,
doesn't it?
It's just nice. Yeah.
At least you're getting something tangible for it.
No, there are five options you can go down for the golden visa route. We primarily focus on the property investment route.
Okay, but if that is of interest, then obviously contact a lawyer and find out what all those options are.
Yeah, definitely.
I say that really is, it's a question of just doing your due diligence.
Yeah. Definitely.
Getting all your information together, seeing exactly what it is you want, how long you want to be here. And
there are other visas as well. So the digital nomad visa, obviously, if you are a resident here and let's say you have a spouse over in the UK and you want to bring them over, there are the family agrupation visas. You know, there's lots of different visas you can look at. But I'd say the main three are the non-lucrative visa, which I didn't mention, is you cannot work on that. You cannot conduct any professional activity on that.
As it says, it's non-lucrative.
Yeah. Exactly. You've got the golden visa where you can continue working, and then the digital nomad visa, which is when you're going to be flexibly working, teleworking from your foreign company, whether it be in the UK or whatever country, but working in Spain.
And as you say, with the due diligence, it makes a huge difference getting your advice from people like Nockolds as opposed to Dave in the pub.
Exactly.
Because, you know, there's always someone in the pub that goes, oh, no, this is what my mate did, or and people are telling you different things. So it's really important getting your advice from professionals.
Right, accredited professionals as well.
Definitely, and actually when you go through the process, sometimes you can even be asked for more information, even if it hasn't been asked for at the beginning. If you provide proof of funds, but then they just want to learn a little bit more, they may ask you to provide more, and if you don't have that professional help, you may not know where to get that document or anything. So
or even that you've got a notification, because that's some of the hardest things here. And they notify you in such different ways that sometimes you don't even know what's happening.
Exactly, yeah.
Very interesting. So if you want to come and live in Spain, there are loads of ways to still do that. But as Hannah's saying, don't listen to the guy down the pub or the girl down the pub or on social media.
Oh, yeah.
Have you seen these groups on the social media that they talk about move to Spain or moving to Spain or living in Spain and all the different people who answered the questions?
And if you look down... People can be really so rude as well.
Very varied, yeah.
Really rude to each other on these groups. Yeah.
Is that what trolling means, being rude on social media?
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah, online.
Assuming so, I'm using the jargon.
Exactly. You've got the lingo. I'm going to take a Nana Nicole here. Is going to check out what does that mean.
There's a lot of varied information there. I would just go straight to the source.
Well, thank you very much, girl.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Remember I was your hero.
Yeah. I'd wear your heart like a soul. Good morning, babe.
Good morning, Spain. Good morning, Spain. Good morning, Spain.
Good morning, Spain.
Good morning, Spain. Buenos dias.
And now, let's go and pay a visit to the Canary Islands, which are known as the sunshine centre of Europe and offer mild temperatures all year round and a range of outstanding natural attractions. In fact, 5 of its 7 islands have been declared a biosphere reserve and the archipelago has 4 national parks.
Monica.
Hi, I'm Paula.
We are sisters and we are here to talk to you because we are the founders of Family Support Group.
And we bring you the doctors, caregivers and nurses to your own house for help you.
Our mom wanted to be at home and we had problems with the healthcare system in Spain because you must talk with a lot of doctors, you must try to investigate many things and many information, and we were absolutely alone.
We can bring you all the medical service to your house.
We want to be your family support group.
No one needs to pass away in a hospital or in a hospice. You can be in your own house with your family.
Call us.
We are here for you.
Well, as we're going to be talking about small dogs with our lovely Nando Brown in Snout and About, I feel like Blue Peter. Here's one I made earlier. Here's my lovely boy, who is a perfect example of a small dog.
Absolutely.
Is he any good for you to use as your examples of the day?
Well, that's the thing, is that small dogs, they are just dogs. They should be treated just as dogs. But something within us as humans makes us treat them completely differently.
I was going to say, what do you mean, just a dog? Do I get up and slap you now? What do you mean, he's just a dog?
So, I mean, they should be treated equally as big dogs, medium dogs, and all the rest of them. Because the thing is that I met a really cute little dog this week, and I made a schoolboy error. Like, I did the thing that I tell everybody not to do, which oh my God. And when you're a little dog, when you're that small, everything in the world is massive.
Yeah.
Like, so even just my hand coming down would be like the equivalent of a bucket on the end of a JCB coming down and scooping you up. You know, we would be absolutely terrified if something came like that. And so many little dogs aren't given the respect or given the time to adapt because we just want to go in and go, hello, mate, how's it going? And the thing is it's easy for me to say that and tell everybody, but not everybody is a dog person. And when they come across a small dog, they do go, oh, he's really cute. Can I say hello? And the person that had this little dog did the right thing. They kind of said, like, give him a bit of space. Don't give him direct eye contact. Just give him a moment to warm up. And I was like, well, yeah, that's very good advice.
Like, I should really know better, sorry.
As a dog trainer?
Yeah.
As you say, you mainly mix with those big brutish dogs that need some kind of, like, guidance as opposed
to... Well, the thing is that we let little dogs get away with a lot more. But actually, the feelings of the dog are the same, no matter if they're little or they're big. Now, whether that's overt aggression, offensive aggression, or whether they're defensive or they're fearful, we need to take into account what it is that's causing the animal to act the way that it's acting. And if it's a rottie and it's scared, like, people will jump on that and go, we need to fix this. Mm. But so many little dogs, they're not given the same respect. Like, they're not given that, this dog is acting like this because he's scared. Now, if he is scared, you still need to take that into account and try and adapt that or start training the dog so he overcomes those fears.
A lot of people do actually say this breed of dog and small dogs in general tend to be yappy and snappy. I mean, it is the reputation they have. And I know when people meet Boy, they're always surprised at how friendly he is. And like now, he's like, it's this never-ending mum. I mean, needy, no, lo siguiente. I mean, it's just so needy. Well, so much needing attention.
Attraction, yeah.
Again, it comes down to the letting little dogs get away with more because dogs do what works, okay? So if he is constantly pawing at you and going, mum, and your response is to go, yes, then he knows that works. And he goes, right, okay, next time I need her attention, I will do that. But again, if it was a Weimaraner or even just a golden retriever or a pit bull, if he was just pawing at you all the time and you wouldn't accept it because, A, it would hurt more.
Yes, it would hurt more.
Ow, give me a bit of space. But you would... you'd start putting training into place because a big brutish dog kind of pushing his way around is less acceptable than a little dog going, oi, oi, mum. So it's dogs do what works. That's the biggest take home you can take from this segment.
Exactly. No different than children, just a dog.
I didn't mean just a dog. I meant an equal.
An equal, I know, I'm being facetious. What can I say? But yes, they can get very needy. They're very, very loving animals. What is it about yappy and, well, he barks a lot, but only really when he wants to say something. So
Again, he's learnt to communicate via that channel. If I'm vocal, then the human will pay attention to me. Mm. And usually I'll get what I want.
Exactly. There's no different than our kids, which takes us into the safety section we want to talk about this week is actually home safety. When my little girl was quite young, a kitchen cupboard, a whole big unit, fell on top of her when she opened two drawers at the bottom. And that was because the unit wasn't fixed to the wall. And yet we hadn't lived there long, and it never occurred to me to go round this kitchen that we did intend to destroy and redo when the time came. But the whole unit, just as she opened too much weight at the bottom, fell down. And if it wasn't that she had these big, thick Barbie-type shoes, sneakers on, she probably wouldn't have made it. It was only because they were wider than her skull that saved her.
Wow.
And apparently, this is a major issue in homes in everyday circumstances. There are thousands of accidents, with some with very serious and lethal results due to furniture falling on children at home.
It's crazy though, isn't it? Because obviously I know that you've got a little boy, but I just can't even imagine that, as you say, like even like going into a house and, as you say, really having to think twice, isn't it? Like if there's a mirror, where you're gonna put it, will that fall? And as you say, like with your little girl, you would never think that the kitchen unit would completely fall on her when she's opening.
Never occurred to me to look and see if it was fixed to the wall. And I hope that this information will help you go and just quickly run around the house when you go somewhere, check to make sure that everything is safe and not going to fall on anyone. Last week's All Things Books with Hannah, she was looking at the Camino de Santiago, and we got to see a little bit of Santiago de Compostela, but not much. So let's go now and take a better look at this fabulous city in Galicia, because it is so well worth a visit.
Spain. Today I'm talking about fiction set in Spain during wartime. The Spanish Civil War was fought from 1936 to 1939 between the Republicans and the Nationalists. Due to the international political climate at the time, the war had many facets and was variously viewed as a class struggle, a religious struggle, a struggle between dictatorship and republican democracy, between revolution and counter-revolution, and between fascism and communism. According to Claude Bowers, who was US ambassador to Spain during the war, it was the dress rehearsal for World War II. The Nationalists won the war, which ended in early 1939, and ruled Spain until Franco's death in November 1975. The war became notable for the passion and political division it inspired worldwide,
but it's still a very sensitive subject for many Spaniards to talk about, particularly those who were around when it happened. Some notable books to mention: Alberto's Lost Birthday. This was written by Diana Rose and published in 2016. It's a really touching story of Alberto, who is old, but he doesn't know how old. He doesn't remember anything before his arrival at an orphanage during the Spanish Civil War. He doesn't think about his childhood until his grandson Tino discovers that he's never celebrated a birthday. Together, they set out to find Alberto's birthday so they can change that. The search takes them deep into the heart of Spain, a country that pledged to forget its painful past. He realizes that he lost part of himself as he hears the stories of courage, cruelty, and love. Another book is Winter in Madrid. This was written by C.J. Sansom and was published a little bit earlier in 2006. It's a spy novel set during the aftermath of the Spanish Civil War in 1940. The main character is wounded veteran Harry Brett, who is recruited by the British Secret Service to make contact with Sandy Forsyth, a shady Madrid-based British businessman. The story is purposely set in Madrid, where Franco resided. One critic actually said that Madrid was almost another character in the novel. There's a book called The Time in Between by Maria Dueñas. This came out in 2009. It's about the character of Sara, who is left penniless in Morocco by her lover when she forges a new identity for herself. Before she knows it, she is the most sought-after couture designer for socialite German Nazi officers' wives. Soon, she's embroiled in a dangerous political conspiracy as she passes information to the British Secret Service through a code stitched into the hems of her dresses. Very clever and very gripping story. And finally, we have The Obedient Assassin. This was written by John P. Davidson. It was published in 2014. It's a novel based on an incredible true story of Ramon Mercada. He was picked from the front lines of the Spanish Civil War by the Soviets to murder Leon Trotsky. He was the leader of the Bolshevik Revolution, exiled in the 1920s for opposing Joseph Stalin. While he's training for the task, he adopts a new identity and lives a lovely life in Paris, befriending famous artists like Frida Kahlo. He's ordered to seduce a left-leaning Jewish woman to get at Trotsky, but falls in love with her instead. It's a great story, and it's mostly true. Hope that inspires some interesting reading this week.
Chef Nick Newman's cooking segments are always so very well received, but you're really going to love this week's because he is being joined by the lovely Lake at just 5 years old and Millie at 4 years old to make mini banana pancakes. Cooking with kids is a wonderful thing to do, not just because they learn how to cook. It's a great opportunity to bond, and it's delicious.
Hello and good morning, Spain. Today I've got two helpers with me, Lake and Millie, and we're going to make some pancakes together, aren't we, girls? So we're going to get right into it. I've got a little pan on, medium heat with some butter and some oil in. Meantime, we're going to make the mix, aren't we, girls? So we need 1.5 cups of flour, so that's 1 cup, isn't it? That's about full. We'll put that in there. And then we need 1/2. So when it's just up to that middle line, do we see? We say that's about 1/2. So that goes in here. And now we need 1 full scoop of sugar. Can you do that for me? And we're gonna put it in here as well. That's about 1/2, that's good. And now Millie, do another 1/2. Good. bit more, that's about right. Yeah, in we go. And now we're gonna put in 2 teaspoons of baking powder. So 2 teaspoons of this. You put in one, that's good. And Millie, you put in one too, please. Little bit more, go and do that one again. Yeah, that's it, right. So we've got all our dried ingredients in here, and we're just gonna give them a little mix. Can we give them a little mix for me, guys? Perfect, good mixing. Okay, now in this next bowl, we're gonna do our eggs. So, right, this is the best way to do an egg. Millie, we'll do one with you first, is just drop it. Drop it. And then all we've got to do is open it up. Okay. And with you, Lake, we're going to do a different one. We're going to crack on the side of the bowl. Nice hard crack. Put our thumbs in and open up. Okay. Now, do we see any shells in there? If we've got any shells, all we're going to do is grab another eggshell and just pull it out with using the other eggshell. See? So, no eggshells in there anymore. We've just got our 2 eggies, okay? And we're gonna go with 240 mils of milk. Good. Now we've gotta mix it. So let's all give it a whisk to try and smash up those eggs first and give them a little mix around. That's it, good work. And now we're gonna go in with our dry ingredients, our flour and our sugar. You keep mixing like a mixing bowl, round and round and round. Round we go, good mixing. That's the way. Let's get that on here so it's nice and easy. We've got to go round and round and round. That's it, teamwork, teamwork. So in here we're just going to put a little bit of zest of lemon as well. That's just going to add some nice flavour when we're cooking our pancakes.
Lemon.
Lovely lemon.
Smells nice.
Smells nice. Right, so let's give this a real good mix. Have a little, don't have to worry if all the lumps are out. We don't have to worry too much, okay? But see how that's nice and mixed now? Hardly even notice when I try to show you. Song is meant to keep you doing what you're supposed to. Good mixing, okay. Now that's nice and mixed, isn't it? So normally what we do is we could put this in the fridge now and just leave it for a little bit and all the bubbles will come up. Not yet, that's for when we've made the pancakes. So we're gonna put it into this jug and then we're gonna put it into this squeezy bottle, okay? So, someone hold this jug for me and someone hold the spoon. Good, spooning it in. Get all that mix into the jug. Good job. That goes from there. And now we're going to pour it into here, okay? I think, oh, you hold this, you two hold this. Nice and tight, make sure it doesn't wobble. Oh, it's going in, I don't want to spin it. That's the way, so we've got that nice there now. Okay. It's really full, isn't it? So, let's put the lid on, okay? And now we're going to make pancakes. So. Our pan is nice and warm, so we have to be super careful when we're working with a hot pan, don't we?
Yeah, so we can't burn ourselves.
Exactly. And see if the pan's hot enough. So we've got to turn over. Lake, you hold the bottle too. Give it a little squeeze. Okay, good. Hold in. Very good. Another one. Another one. All the way around, so it looks like a clock, doesn't it?
How about okay. In the middle?
Right, a bit more on this one here.
Whoa.
Wow, lots of little ones there, haven't we?
Is this like some flour?
So what we're going to do now is we're going to put a banana on the middle of each one. Okay, do we all like bananas?
Yeah.
Do you like bananas, Lake? Okay, so let's take a banana and put it in the middle. Good one. And now you, good one. Close enough. Another one in the middle like that. Good.
Daddy, this one.
In the middle, careful not to touch the pan. Good. Good. In the middle, that's it. Good. That's okay. Now, last one I'll do, okay? Right, so we've got our pancakes back on the stove now, okay? They're going to be bananas in the middle. So, what we're going to do now is we're going to put a little bit more mixture on the top of each banana, okay?
Okay.
Okay,
then
so.
Get it all together.
Yeah, but we're going to let it cook just for a little bit, okay?
Yeah.
The rest of the mix on top of the bananas, okay? Let's do it together, hands away from the pan, keeping nice and safe. Good. Covering that banana up. Good job.
Cover
that banana.
That one.
That's it. I'll do these last two because they're this side. Just want to cover up the banana, okay?
I'm going to do the middle.
And now we're going to flip them. So we've got to wait until we can see lots of bubbles coming from the pancake mix. Can you tell me when you see that? You see how these little bubbles are coming?
I can see the bubbles coming, like shiny.
Shine, yeah. So, so let's flip them all over. I'm going to do the flipping part, okay? Just because it's a little bit hot.
You're just flipping.
That's it. See them now looking nice and golden? So that means that they're ready to go. Okay, so we're going to plate up. We'll just flip them over again, make sure they're nice on both sides.
You need to flip them like flip.
Okay, should we start plating up?
Yeah.
Okay, let's put the pancakes onto the plate. I'll nice stack them all up in the middle. We'll finish them off, hang on. It's going to be really hot, like just wait 2 seconds and we'll put some sprinkles on top and some chocolate. Wait 2 seconds, please, Millie. Yeah, we'll put some chocolate on top. Okay, get this pan out of the way. Okay, should we put some, do you want to put some sprinkles on top? Let's put a little bit of sprinkles on top. Very nice. How about some nuts? Some nice toasted almonds, yeah? Very good. How about some chocolate? Should we put some chocolate on top of there too?
And some white too.
And some white chocolate too? Okay, let me take this one and we're gonna do it like this, just grate it across. See?
Daddy.
Yeah, that's good. You can grate it like this. Very good. Okay, they look really good. Do you wanna do the best part now? Should we do some tasting? You've got white as well. Do you want to taste them now? Get in the forks, make sure they're not too hot. Gonna give them a blow.
This one.
You have that one if you want. Like, which one are you gonna have? That's a good choice.
This one got so much sprinkles on.
Mmm. That's good, extra sprinkles. Right, let's do the taste test. What do we think? This is our breakfast banana stuffed pancakes. Oh, they're good, aren't they? Thumbs up?
Mm-hmm.
Thumbs up?
It's delicious. I can feel the banana.
You should feel the banana in the middle. That is our breakfast pancakes. Thank you very much and good morning. Say good morning, everyone. Morning.
Good morning.
Need to pay attention to the alarm. Wake up slow. Wake up slow. But baby, you hardly even notice when I try to show you this song is meant to keep you from doing what you're supposed to. Waking up too early, maybe we could sleep. Make you banana pancakes, pretend like it's the
make my day. Make my day.
Well, that really is all we have time for this week. Thank you so much for joining us. We hope you found it entertaining and informative. We will see you again next week, but don't forget you can check out the programmes online from our YouTube channel and from many other places. The important thing is that you join us and that you have a good day and a good week. Look after yourselves and we'll be back again next week. See you soon. Bye-bye.
Oh, no, bye. No, no.